welcome to Martial Arts Today, a program dedicated to the ancient fighting arts of the Orient, designed to give you insights into the history, philosophy, styles, and celebrities of the martial arts. And now, your host, Joe Rebelo.
Hi, this is Joe Rebelo with Martial Arts Today, and we're here with a very special guest, Mr. Mike Depasquale. Now, Mr. Depasquale is one of the premier jiu-jitsu practitioners here in the United States and comes from a fine, long tradition of jiu-jitsu. He's here today in Fall River at the Ravens Academy of Self-Defense doing a series of seminars on the art of jiu-jitsu. First of all, Mike, it's a pleasure meeting you.
Pleasure to be here. Pleasure.
Mike, the first question I wanted to ask, you know, and again, I'm sure you've been asked this many times, how did you start up in the martial arts?
I started up, actually, I had no real alternative but to start in the martial arts as a young boy, about 5 years old, 6 years old. My father is obviously a pioneer. Most people know that my father is a pioneer in jiu-jitsu. And also, he studied a lot of karate and judo. I originally started in judo. My father used to bring us up to the judo twins when he was training the judo twins dojo over in New York. I do believe it was on 36th. In Broadway, somewhere around there at the time, back in 19, oh geez, I don't even know the date, but it was quite a while ago. We won't mention the date. But I studied as a judo practitioner when I was a kid. My father started a school in Bergenfield when I was about 10 years old under the police athletic league, or I should say in the police athletic league building, which is under the police department in Bergenfield, New Jersey. That's where I started really my first school. My father had his first school, and then we moved to Closter. Opened the school up, and he did a series of different things there, including a movie for Paramount, which was the first, no one even knows this, but we did a movie for Paramount Pictures. It was a sports and action film, and it was narrated by Chris Schenkel. It was the first film, feature or film, even though it was a short, ever done by a major motion picture studio ever in this country. And it was done by Paramount, the whole mountain, the beginning had the mountain. And it was kind of like my, you know, my mother had started up where a guy was following my mother out of the car, and she ends up throwing him into a lake, and they built the dojo outside the back of our school because they couldn't fit the cameras in. And it was interesting because I was in it. I was about 12, 13 years old, but it was, you know, and it shot to my father, explained that, you know, Mike Depasquale Sr. owns a school in close to New Jersey. But it was the first movie, and it was during the Vietnam era when it was out. And I remember that the people that had gone to Vietnam years later told me that they saw it in Vietnam. And I remember seeing it with the Blue Max in the movie theater, when you used to sit in the movie theater and watch the movies before the movie, they have a 10-minute short on skiing or boating or whatever. And they had this movie from Paramount, which was, again, I mean, I'm very proud of it. No, very few people know it, but it was the first American film martial art movie made by a motion picture studio in this country.
Oh, that's a fantastic accomplishment. That's great. Now, again, as you got involved in jiu-jitsu, again, starting in judo and then studying with your father in jiu-jitsu, tell me something, for the general public, what is the difference between judo and jiu-jitsu?
Well, judo actually is a sport that it was derived from jiu-jitsu. A man named Jigoro Kano, who was a jiu-jitsu practitioner who actually had a system called Kano Jitsu, was an individual that tried in his mind to figure out a way to compete so that you can have a competition in jiu-jitsu. I mean, I'm talking about a competition that would be a legitimate sport-like competition without having any kind of real injury and killing anybody. But he came up with the sport of judo, so that he made rules and regulations to the throwing techniques and to a lot of the techniques that are used in judo, the armbar locks and of course the choke outs that are used with the gis, grappling techniques such as getsukatami, katakatami, your throws like taitosho, goshi, or uchigari, or sotogari, yamarashi. They're all throws that do come from jiu-jitsu. And Jigoro Kano obviously broke it down and started working, grabbing lapel, grabbing a sleeve, and using kazushi, using body leverage and counter movements, so that it would become sport-oriented, similar to a collegiate wrestling type of as opposed to a hardcore Greco-Roman style wrestling. It's a little bit different, although it's still on a collegiate type level. So judo does come from jiu-jitsu. It is the jiu-jitsu is, which is actually pronounced jiu-jitsu. You know, and many people call it jiu-jitsu. Jiu-jitsu is spelled in about five different ways. And they're all, for the most part, the right way of spelling. It's just different ways to spell it. But jiu-jitsu is an art form that really started a lot of other art forms and started a lot of other sports, primarily judo and, of course, karate. A lot of the karate systems come from jiu-jitsu. And, of course, you have your aikido practitioners, aikijutsu. They all stem from jiu-jitsu, which is your mother of the arts.
Now, again, jiu-jitsu literally was the catch-all phrase for all forms of martial arts in Japan, empty hand arts, I should say.
It was, and jiu-jitsu really actually means gentle art, as much as it doesn't have to be gentle. I mean, it was called a gentle art because of the movement in it that it practiced. It showed that things could be done gently and can be very devastating. Although I believe that, you know, today's day and age, the way that people are practicing jiu-jitsu and the way I teach jiu-jitsu is more combative. It's gentle to a degree, I think, until you reach the point of impact where if you're going to choke someone or use an armbar lock or whatever, it doesn't become gentle. I mean, you know, it can be gentle when you're practicing, and it's a gentle practice. It's an art that you actually practice gently on the mat in the traditional sense of the word.
You know, what I found fascinating about jiu-jitsu, as you mentioned, was the aspect of Jiu, of gentleness, that, you know, when a person looks at the grappling aspect of it, they say, well, that's the gentle approach to it, not realizing that, like you said, the original form of jiu-jitsu, it had everything, and it had atemi, the striking arts, the shimewaza, the takedowns, the throws.
Every jiu-jitsu practitioner, and I believe this, I mean, again, most of your art forms stem from jiu-jitsu. It's called the mother of the arts. I believe that if you're a good jiu-jitsu practitioner, you could do just about anything. And I've proven that, actually, in my own life, because I've won, I mean, numerous amount of karate tournaments, and I've won the East Coast Championships in 1981, which very few people know. I was qualified for the Pan American Team Trials. I fought with people like Togi Hill and Billy Blanks back in the early days. And I did a lot of judo competition, won shiais in my time, and competed in kickboxing in Gary Alexander's first kickboxing league back in, 1977. I did an awful lot that, I mean, stemmed from my jiu-jitsu background and my judo background. So, I mean, yeah, I think that, yeah, jiu-jitsu, if you're a good jiu-jitsu practitioner, you're well-balanced and you're well-rounded. Most of your karate, a good jiu-jitsu practitioner, is not to say that karate people can't pick up jiu-jitsu, they can. So a good jiu-jitsu practitioner can adapt real well to other art forms, especially the karate. And competitively speaking, he knows how to use his blocks. He knows how to use his kicks. He's very good with his hand strikes. And I've always seen good jiu-jitsu practitioners be able to go into a karate class and have no problem, or a judo class, have no problem holding his own. So it's important to be able to understand, when you have a jiu-jitsu background, that the other parts of your background, such as your kicking and your arts and your punching arts with karate, those types of particular art forms are much easier to pick up.
Well, it is that diversity of being a jiu-jitsu practitioner that I can really appreciate, because, again, as you mentioned before, you know, you've been a kickboxer, you've been involved in karate competitions, and, you know, it was really part of that diversity that when I saw you getting involved in the film career. You know, let's talk about a little bit about that. You know, you've been featured in King of the Kickboxers, China Heat. What are some of the other productions? And first of all, how did you get involved in movies and films?
Well, actually, I got involved in movies and films through my publication and the people I was starting to meet. I always was interested in movies, action movies. I did a movie back in 1965, I think, around there. We did a movie for Paramount Pictures. I was intrigued. I was intrigued with the film industry. My brother Arnold was also in the film industry for quite a while. He was a student filmmaker when he was going to college, and he knew everybody. And you know, in his back room, we had the dojo in the office. He had like a projection room there, and he had all kinds of films and 35 millimeter. And it's a shame he got out of it, because he probably would be somebody that would be a big director today. He knew everybody back then. He knew Stallone, knew all these different people, and he was always involved in the film industry. So I was always curious about when he used to do things. I used to see that when I was growing up, and I was in my teens. But no, I got involved in these projects mostly from the people I met in the martial art industry, and asked if I wanted to do some things. Some people like Keith Strandberg, who writes for my magazine, and just finished a production which I was supposed to shoot actually as Night Stalker for 6 weeks. I couldn't do it because I'm doing an interactive video production right now with a company called Major Vision out of Chicago, which is a bunch of characters I created called the Max Team. And we're working on that project. They're going to spend quite a bit of money on it. as for kids, and it's going to have a lot of live action in it. It's going to be a regular movie-type setting with kids getting involved in the interactive end of it, going for, it's called The Quest for Caesar's Sword, and going to get that sword back, which is a magical sword that Caesar owned, once owned. And we're going to take the kids on an exercise program and then go after the sword in different phases of it and fighting off bad guys with this Max team, which are six characters. So it's, I mean, I'm involved in the production and more now than anything else. I want to get involved in producing. I have two scripts that this company is also going to probably produce with me, along with me, which I'll probably, you know, do some work in there, maybe even star on one of them. But I got involved in it mostly through the people I met through the magazine. I mean, I was asked to do certain things. I took on the challenge, King of the Kickboxers. I did the part with Billy Blanks and the opening scene as the big brother. It was a very interesting part, which got me really intrigued in the film industry. I did American Shaolin with Keith, helping actually produce part of that by using my tournament at the time. I had a big, gigantic Special Olympics tournament with 700 competitors. We did exterior shots there, and a lot of my equipment was used for the beginning of it. China Heat was something I started in China. I went to China for 10 weeks and did a movie called China Heat, Paid in Blood, which is actually an excellent movie. A lot of action in it, and it hasn't been shown here because of the soundtrack is not really set. It's actually China. In China, unfortunately, they use soundtracks from over here, and it's not really legal to do that. But it's a good movie, but it's a great experience. I went along Shanghai, shot it in Shanghai, I was treated like a king. I was probably the second American in a film group ever to go to Shanghai and do a movie. Spielberg was the first with his movie. I think The Last Emperor was first. Their co-crew was there doing that film. And then I came along and Shanghai Film Studios actually produced it with this company, Golden Sun. And we went from there to Dalian. I shot a bunch. It was kind of interesting working with all Chinese people. And
yeah, I was going to say, what's it like working with a whole Chinese cast?
It was interesting. For 10 good, I was there for the first time I was there, I think, for 8 weeks. And I went back for three to do some retakes. It was kind of interesting because they treated me great. I mean, I had an interpreter and everything, and but it was a lot of work. 12, 13, 14-hour days. And there you're on top of a mountain in a bus waiting to shoot your scene, you know, in a freezing cold on a beach in the middle of November. It looks beautiful and looks sunny, but it's not. It was freezing. But it was interesting. It was an interesting experience, and it was something I would have never in a million years, you know, ever looked back on and say, well, I'm disappointed that I did. I was very happy I did it. And at this point, it was something I look back on and really, with a smile on my face, say, hey, you know, it gave me something to learn about. But at this point in time, I just did a movie with Donna Dragon Wilson and Art Camacho's production called The Power Within, which I star as the karate instructor with all the kids in the school. And it wasn't a big part. It was two different parts in the movie. And Art shot it with myself as the instructor. And then Dom was in it as a special guest in my dojo. And, you know, it was kind of an interesting scene. But I'm getting involved in a bunch. A lot of people have been asking me to do different things, but I haven't really said yes to a lot of them only because of my time restraints. I really have a lot of commitments to a lot of different things that I'm doing right now.
Now, the final question I wanted to ask you, and you mentioned a little bit earlier, and I really want to touch upon this. With the passing, again, you mentioned Pete Sampaio Sr., you know, who great, had just passed away, J.T. Will, another
also
gentleman who had just passed away. Ruiz, oh, really?
In Hackensack, New Jersey. He wasn't Hackensack, New Jersey. I forget his first name exactly, but I knew him for a while. 57-year-old died of a heart. 54 died. Had a very large following. Had like a 1,500 member organization. Very, very big. And he just, God rest his soul, passed away last week of a heart attack.
And Frank Ruiz from Nisei Goju, who just passed away on the 20th of June.
I was with him when I was 10 years old. Governor's Island, Isaac Henry's wife's black belt test. I was only a kid. My father was there. And Frank was in good health back then when he was younger. But I knew him and Chuck Merriman, who I was with this past weekend. I mean, I have pictures of him when he had a crew cut and glasses on, and he was 22 years old, you know, 23 years old when I was a little boy. But these are all people that I was raised with, I trained with, and it's sad to see them passing. And I know that a lot of them are not well, and that's one of the reasons why I try to do things for them. Next week I have Professor V, Wally J, my father, George Zuma, Wally, Remy Priest, there's a whole bunch, Joe Lewis, Bill Wallace at my camp in Radford, Virginia, where the Karate College is. And I always try to pay tribute to them, just as I did with 2 years ago. I have a tape on, as a matter of fact, with Wally J, Professor Duncan, Professor V, my father, Pete Sirigano Sr., Antonio Pereira, Ronnie Van Cleef, they're all on this video teaching, and it's a Grandmasters in Action video. It's a great video. But I did that for a reason, because I wanted to pay tribute to these people that meant a lot to me, even though Ronnie's not that old. He's, you know, he's a good guy, and I like him. And, of course, Ronald Duncan was there, too. And he was somebody that I've known for a long time. And a lot of good people, you know. Everybody has their ups and downs in life, you know. It's one of those things. I've known people like Moses Powell, and it's just been an interesting life for me, because I had an opportunity where a lot of other people didn't, to meet the true people that pioneered jiu-jitsu and karate in America. I mean, you know, Don Nagel, all these guys were my personal friends from my father.
Well, I was going to say, I mean, you were in a very fortunate position, because being the son of such a famous martial artist.
Yeah, my father was definitely one of the true pioneers, and I'm not afraid to say that, in jiu-jitsu, and a great, great, great human being. I only hope that I can even be an ounce of what he is. I mean, you know, he's a very bright, brilliant man. And I've been very, very fortunate. At the same time, I'm very disciplined in my life. I mean, he gave me a tremendous amount of discipline as a youngster. I had to go places when I didn't want to. I had to be with him constantly, with my brothers in the dojo and at demonstrations. There was no going out to play as much as the average kid would, because I was always with him in the dojo 4 or 5 times a week. Literally lived on the mat. I mean, I spent at least 20 hours a week on the mat when I was, you know, from 5, 6, 7 years old up, because my father would come home from work and he had a dojo at 6 o'clock. You'd go with him, you'd be there till 8:30 at night, and my mother would pick us up. And then on Saturdays, forget it, you'd be there all day Saturday from 9 o'clock in the morning till like 4 o'clock in the afternoon. You know, he taught like 2 classes, and they were 2-hour classes, the good classes back then. So it was kind of interesting, but it was also very hard. Also, my father was kind of a real disciplinarian. But I love him dearly, and I have no regrets at this point in my life. It's given me an opportunity in my life to better myself and move forward into better, bigger arenas. You know, so it's been good. I just recently did a video, a couple of videos of my 522 videos on the market now on jiu-jitsu, all different types, doing very well. And I just did a video on Heppyryu Jodo, which is my father's cane and his pressure point. I have one of them, and it's been interesting.
Well, I'll tell you, I mean, you've definitely, again, through the example of your father, become a real Renaissance man. And thank you very much for your time and your effort, and we'll be back with more martial arts today. Stay tuned.
It's like me playing possum. Please, I didn't do anything. Well, this guy, what do you think he's saying? His mind is saying, hey, I want to kill this guy. Hey, you're a woman, he wants to rape you. You know, he's saying, well, you know, hey, it's easy prey. Their mind immediately drops. And this is the streetwise end of what I'm trying to teach you. It's not the self-defense hardcore martial arts side. It's how you react in a situation when you're in trouble. If you're in trouble, I don't care how big you are, how tough you are, how you look. Meanest guy in the world, you have scars all over your face, it's all over, but it doesn't matter what you look like. Hey, I don't want any trouble. No problem. I don't look like I'm a baby. I'm just saying, listen, I don't want any trouble. But from this position here, I'm preparing myself. Because I can lift my legs, I can move here, I can move here, I can go anywhere I want. Be evasive and be prepared instead of doing it. Yeah, come on. And say to this guy, okay, now your mind is conditioned because I'm ready for you. And you're saying, well, what's my way around this guy? You want to go kill you, son of a gun. If I'm like this, hey, I don't want any trouble. He's saying, you know what? You're going to get trouble. You're going to get trouble, you like it or not. All of a sudden, he's walking into your zone, not knowing that you're like a tiger. Okay? And that tiger, when a lamb is a lamb, it can turn into a tiger whenever it wants to. Okay? So what I'm saying is, when you're doing this, hey, I don't want any trouble, you're a lamb, you look like a lamb, but underneath that lamb's coat is a tiger instinct. It's a tiger waiting for that guy to walk into that zone. All of a sudden, you strip the lamb off, and all of a sudden, you're a tiger. Understand that mentality that comes to, I don't teach just the street self-defense side when it comes to the physical side. I'm trying to teach you the mental side of how you react. Okay, but you're always prepared. If something like that does happen, you want to know that you can do something about it. You want to know that, yeah, after the first grab, after the first swing, okay, or when he is swinging, you're going to be able to move off of that. Okay, so he comes in from here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right here. Ultimately, when a guy has a big arm, it's great because it's like, although the guy, even though he has a lot much arm, it doesn't matter. Watch my hand. Point. Point. No problem. Now this, don't let go of this. Separate this. See his face? What did I tell you about the ear before? These kind of motions. Well, you said to use it. Okay, you can do a lot of things from here. Don't be afraid to use them, people.
Mr. Foster, can I ask a question?
Sure.
On the arm, you hold the arm as you're doing all the strikes and of the takedown as well. Are you holding on to the arm?
I always hold on. When I get a hold of the arm, I let go of it.
All right.
I hang on to you. I'm like, the way I look at it, it's like, when you have a monkey swinging from a vine, take a look at a monkey swinging from a vine, from one vine to the other vine, he never lets go of the vine.
Right.
Grabs it, same thing here. You hang on to somebody, you hang on to somebody. Understand? So when a man comes in with this, the key here again, people, as he's moving, I'll use you again. Come over here. With a right hand, a straight punch. No. Come with a straight punch here. I gotta move my feet. Understand? Move my feet. Now I gotta move my feet again. And now I'm in here. I want you guys, judo throws are probably the best self-defense techniques you could use in the street. People don't realize it. Judo comes from jiu-jitsu anyhow. But judo techniques, your sweeps, your sotagari, your uchigari, koshiku, they're great. I just did a video of Mike Swain, like I was explaining before, who's probably the best judo player in this country. He was actually the only world champ we ever had in this country, four-time Olympian. And I'll tell you something, judo throws, I mean, watching him in action doing judo throws, and then, I mean, I was a judo player when I was a kid, and then putting it into a combative form, I mean, it just went to, I mean, especially watching him do it the way he did, because he does it a lot faster than I do it. Because that's all they do is they train, they come in, they come out, they come in, they come out, they hip, throw, they crawl on the ground, do all kinds of drills, but they get speed from it. Watching him, and then obviously applying the street version, how I was showing how you can apply these particular motions he was showing in the sport form into a combative form, off a choke, off a punch, whatever, it just, for the most part, gave me a much more positive outlook on how judo really can apply to the street. And Gracie, you see the Ultimate Fighting Championship, phenomenal. I mean, all he does is adapt the judo concept, which he's a judo, they're judo people for the most part, and taking some of the techniques which you're not allowed to use in judo. You're not allowed to use chokeholds or, you know, certain locks. It's illegal. And just applying those particular jiu-jitsu concepts to the judo concept. That's all it is. No different. As he throws around, as long as he's throwing a hard, they call it dead arm block, throwing a hard round. This way. Notice the balance. Notice the off-balance here? You feel a block? I'm hitting what they call the radial nerve here. Okay, when I'm not worried about hitting it to the point where it hurts that much. Yeah, it's going to stun me. I'm worried about setting myself up. As he comes in the roundhouse punch, as in this position here, as soon as I block, I roll off this. The minute he thinks, okay, uh-oh, he's in trouble, it's too late. I have him hit on the larynx, I have a lock. If I decide to take my hand here and do this, I'll bring him to a stone. Watch. Up and down, it's not going anywhere. Now, from this position here, we want to just rotate the hand up, boom. We want to come in, we want to take the man down from this position here. Watch this motion here. This is more of your combat motion. If it stays here, all we do is we trap the man's face. I call pyramiding the man. We take the foot here, because now what the man's gonna think about is my leg before anything else. Is, hey, you know what, I have put a leg over my face and I don't like it there. So he's immediately gonna think about trying to get this out of the way, but we're gonna get this foot coming out. As we get this foot coming out, as he starts to push off his leg, push any way he wants, he can push it right to the other foot. Now I have a lock. Now I lock and I rotate. I'm talking about rather push. I can just raise my hips and pull back. But if I lock, his shoulders caught my crock on my legs here. Understand? I'm not way back like a lot of people lock on these. Sliding way back, too far back. If I'm too far back here, and I'm trying to lock back here, okay, most people expect new locks like this. Okay, when they'll put their foot over here and they'll lock this way. Always, don't ever forget this. Lock your legs. Never, ever, ever let your legs hang like you'll see a lot of people do. Because this is dangerous. You won't get a lock that well. Yeah, I can have it here, but if he pushes my legs, he's smart, he'll roll right out of this. Okay, I'm in big trouble, or the other way as well. If he decides to push his foot this way, go ahead and roll this way. Understand? Now I have to start going into these type of techniques, and these kind of techniques, and these kind of locks. I still have them. But the point of the matter is, why lose them to begin with? So keep it tight in here, lock in here, raise in here. If he starts to pull you and you're weaker than he is, and he wants his arm back, come up with him. Let him have that, like I showed you before. As he starts to pull, you're here, give him a little torque. I can play with him a little bit, all of a sudden, let him come up. Now I have a foot here, I have a pressure point, a carotid artery, I have a lock in here. I also have, boom, 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 boom. Okay, anywhere you want to go with this foot. At the same time, I'm doing this. As he comes in, hard round punch. In here, this position here, in, lock up, side spin down. Pulls up, in here, lock up, just get in here. Look, big guys. Throws a punch and he passes his shoulder. Okay, you have to be able to move with the man's punch. The key here is to stun the guy. As he comes in with a punch, here, now what you guys are going to do is I'm going to show you this. Well, in reality, I'm going to pick the guy up right off the ground. As I pick him up, pay attention to me, I'm going to throw him and land on him. See my knees are not on the ground? When I land on him, I'm going to knock the wind out of him. I'm going to lock. I'm going to extend the head. What I'm going to do with the head here is I'm going to hyperextend the neck. Take a look closely over here. My hand comes in here. And he tries to get out, he grabs whatever you want. There's no way out of this. If the hand comes to the face here, and you don't have this hand, he starts to push away here, you take this, shove it here, and you lock it here. As they call it, kata katami. It's a lot stronger, but we don't want, normally when you fall, I want to have this hand so I can lock it here. If I extend it here, I'll break your arm here too, and here. I have fingers in here, I get under here, and lock it here. I have a nose in here if I want also.
Thank you.